Hi guys, welcome back, or welcome to DreamWorks Switch to Life, and in today's video, we're going to be reviewing the third TV show of the Kung Fu Panda franchise, that of course being Kung Fu Panda, The Dragon Knight. I really enjoyed watching this series, and you can find it streaming on Netflix, but for the most part, there's some stuff you have to know before going in. The series has a total of 43 episodes, but despite that, it tells one single story across the entire series. That's 17 hours worth of TV. However, it's not like The Paws of Destiny, where it's best binged, because 17 hours, that's way too long for one binge session. At the same time, each episode of the series, unlike The Paws of Destiny, tells its own unique story. For instance, you have an entire episode dedicated to one thing, and then the next episode is completely different, and yet they both move the overall story forward until the series finale. So, unlike The Paws of Destiny, where you pretty much have to binge the show in order to understand it, this one, you can actually just watch one episode at a time and you'll be fine. So, how good is this series? Honestly, it's really good. I loved the overall story, but before we get into that, let's talk about the things that make the show great. The voice acting, amazing. The best voice acting in any of the Kung Fu Panda TV shows. A large part of that has to do with the fact that they brought Jack Black into voice Po, which is amazing. And then there's also James Hong as Mr. Ping, but at the same time, that's pretty much it. That's it for our returning cast. We don't see any of the Furious Five. We don't see Shifu. And despite the fact that there's a few episodes that take place in Panda Village, we don't see any pandas, including Lee Shan. And that's kind of disappointing, actually, because, I mean, the whole point of Po living in Panda Village is so he can be with his family. And while we do get a bunch of scenes with him and Mr. Ping interacting with each other, there's no Lee Shan. And that's honestly a little disappointing, but I think it makes sense considering they couldn't bring his actual movie voice actor back, and it probably would throw off people if they brought back his TV show voice actor. At the same time, could Lee Shan have even added anything to the plot? Well, no, actually. He didn't really need to be there, and I guess that's why his character was probably cut or maybe even not considered. But still, it would have been nice if he showed up in like a small cameo, at least. And then of course, there's the other voice actors who voice the brand new characters for the series, and I gotta say, I really enjoyed listening to them, especially when it came to the characters from other countries, mainly England, as they actually gave an English accent to those characters, and I really enjoyed that. Oh, yeah, one thing I forgot to mention, this show is actually a globe-trotting adventure for Po. People have been asking for Kung Fu Panda to travel to other lands, not just stay in China. And unfortunately, I think that doing it in a movie is asking for a problem because you might be rushing the plot. But by turning it into a series, it actually gives you time to let Po discover these new lands and cultures, and especially learn about them, and it's really cool. At the same time, however, there are quite a few instances where there were unnecessary scenes, unfortunately. Again, while every single episode moves the story forward, there are instances where most of the episode could literally be scrapped and it's just filler. And it's not a case of one or two episodes, they literally drag out multiple episodes so that the episode can tell its own unique story, while again, still moving the plot forward slowly. A big example of this is in episode 7 of the series, where Po has a character regression where instead of being his confident self, he's scared of pretty much everything, and he has to overcome that obstacle throughout the episode. Sadly, however, that feels like a character regression. It's completely unnecessary, and there's no reason to include it. I mean, this series is supposed to take place after everything in the Kung Fu Panda franchise, including Kung Fu Panda 4, which is a bit unfortunate because that means Po has gone through a bunch of character development. He's had 4 movies, 2 TV shows, not to mention a bunch of short films, and the thing is, He still has that character regression so that he can develop in that one single episode for no good reason at all. It's really sad and disappointing, actually. So, yes, while it's very clear that they dragged this out, filling it with a bunch of filler episodes, at the same time, I don't think they could have shortened this plot to the point where it was just movie length. There's no way they could do that without it feeling rushed. And personally, I'm more so a fan of things being dragged out than I am of them feeling rushed. So yeah, I think a TV show for Poe's globe-trotting adventure was the right way to go. Now, onto the animation quality, it's kind of good. I mean, I love the animation and it's nice, but at the same time, it actually kind of feels like a downgrade from the Paws of Destiny. Sometimes the lip syncing doesn't add up, and while I do enjoy the characters' designs and models, their movements aren't really that fluid compared to the Paws of Destiny. Still, it's really good animation and I enjoy it, more so than I could ever enjoy the Legends of Awesomeness animation, but still. And then there's the music, which I really enjoyed. The background music was honestly really amazing, and it's really cool how they got a bunch of cultural experiences to shine through in the music. You have Chinese music, Indian music, England music, and even some music that sounds like it would originate from Peru or something like that. And now we've reached that point. It is time to dive into the story. I will be rushing through a lot of the episodes as there is a lot to cover. So here it goes. Poe is going on a food tour and his first stop is the home of the Wu Gao Gauntlet, where two weasels, Klaus and Veruca, decide to show up and take the Wu Gao Gauntlet and they manage to succeed. However, not before Poe accidentally destroys the village using the Wu Gao Gauntlet's mystical earthbending powers. So the weasels not only get away with the gauntlet, but Poe, having destroyed the village, loses his title of Dragon Master when the Emperor decides to take it away from him. Then a Knight of England shows up on Poe's doorstep as she is hunting the weasels, Klaus and Veruca.
My name is Luthera of Landreth, the Wandering Blade, daughter of the Saxon god, Knight of England. And you?
I'm Poe.
And that's about all I got right now. Title pending, so.
And Poe decides to tag along with her so he can not only bring the weasels to justice, but also get his title back as it will help boost his reputation again. And thus begins the globe-trotting adventure where they have to cross a lava bridge, then they have to figure out what Klaus and Veruca's plan is, and it involves using the Changsheng weapons, four magical weapons that were created by the ancient Kung Fu masters who decided to use it to control the elements and trap the souls of their enemies. Unfortunately, their power was so great that it literally divided the world, making it so Pangaea was split into multiple lands. And thus the masters decided to hide the weapons as they couldn't actually destroy them. So, now that the weasels have the Wu Gao Gauntlet, they're going after the Whip of Endless Flame. So, Poe and Wandering Blade have to beat them to it, which is a problem since they don't know where it is. But they do know that an author who wrote a graphic novel that Poe has knows about the Changsheng weapons, as the book is literally talking about them. Unfortunately, the book doesn't explain where it's hidden, so they go to seek out the author, whose son ends up giving them a map that leads them to the Lost City where the whip is hidden, and it's there that they meet Rookmini, a master thief and con artist who's been trapped inside of the Lost City for 30 years with only the whip and a bunch of moss people to keep her company. At the same time, Poe and Wandering Blade are being hunted by a mysterious stranger who goes by the name Colin. Turns out this stranger is actually a Knight of England, and he's been sent to capture Luthera of Landreth, who is pretending to be a knight as she was never actually knighted. In fact, the sword she's carrying around is her dead brother's, and she's just been using it to try to fulfill her mission of destroying Klaus and Veruca, the weasels who ended up killing her brother. And this ends up eventually leading to a showdown at the Emperor's Palace, where Rook Mini tries to sell the Whip of Endless Flame to the Emperor for half of China's treasury, and of course, there's a fight between Po, Blade, Klaus, Veruca, the Emperor, Rook Mini, Colin, and Mr. Ping was there for some reason. And of course, the season ends with the cliffhanger where Klaus and Veruca have the Wu Gao gauntlet still, but Rook Mini, who has the Whip of Endless Flame, ends up teaming up with the Dragon Knight so that together they can hunt down the rest of the Changsheng weapons and put a stop to Klaus and Veruca once and for all. Which leads to season 2, where they travel to India to find Master Mastodon's pendant, which will actually take them to the Master Mastodon's storm wheels, which control the lightning. And unfortunately, that pendant isn't actually a map, it's a trap, and it contains the ghost of Master Mastodon, who decides to possess Mr. Ping's body when he breaks the pendant. Thankfully, Master Mastodon eventually agrees to team up with the Dragon Knights, which results in them traveling to South America, where they've discovered that the storm wheels were actually not in their hiding place, and were picked up and stolen by someone else. After figuring out who that someone is, which is apparently the Queen of Tekal, they decide to play a pock-to-pock game, which is, you know, kind of gives me the Road to El Dorado vibes. But when they win the pock-to-pock game, it gives them an audience with the Queen, who tells them that she managed to find the storm wheels, but she only has one of them, as the other was stolen by a mad scientist who is living in a volcano named Akna. Turns out, Akna was trying to figure out why Tekal was getting so much water while her village was getting drowned out. And that's the thing. Turns out the storm wheels have the power to control the sky and the storm. But unfortunately, that means while Tekal was getting an abundance of water, the water was actually being stolen from Akna's village. So Akna had to figure out a way to make it so that things could go back to normal by taking the storm wheels. Unfortunately, she only managed to take one. And she decided to destroy the storm wheel, but unfortunately she couldn't. And it turns out that Alfie, who is Luthera's brother, decided to take the storm wheel back to England with him so he could destroy it there. In the meanwhile, Klaus and Veruca have been having their own adventure where they discover an island filled with lost mages, and they happen to be in possession of the Helmet of Winds, which is the final Changsheng weapons. So Klaus and Veruca take the Helmet of Winds, and then they come to South America to find the storm wheels, and thus a battle ensues where Po and the Dragon Knights figure out that the Changsheng weapons really are too powerful and they're supposed to be destroyed. And the only way they can do that is, well, we'll get to that later. Unfortunately, the Changsheng weapons were lost when the Queen of Tekal interfered with the battle and took the weapons for herself, basically becoming the most powerful person in the entire world. Luthera decides to have a final battle against the weasels, during which she decides to try to kill Klaus, while Veruca just decides to run away. Unfortunately, she decides to have a moment of weakness, which makes it so that Klaus actually doesn't die, but Veruca still thinks that Luthera killed her brother, which is a bit disappointing, actually. Klaus is given a new chance of life, but we don't actually see what he does with it until the next season. Meanwhile, Po, Master Mastodon, and everyone in Tekal are preparing for the final battle against the Queen of Tekal, which is actually a bit of a problem considering that they don't have anything that can stand up to her power, with the exception of Master Mastodon's elemental powers. Unfortunately, due to Mr. Ping's weak goose body, he can't actually access them. So Po offers up his own body, which Master Mastodon's soul ends up going into, and thus Po has two souls inside of him. Unfortunately, during the final battle, Po and Master Mastodon are defeated by one of the Changsheng weapons, the Storm Wheels, which is unfortunate because the whole point of the Changsheng weapons is that whoever they defeat in battle, those soul becomes trapped inside the weapons. And with two souls inside of Po's body, that means only one of them has to sacrifice themselves. And of course, Master Mastodon, he's lived for 1,000 years. He has nothing left to offer the world. Po, he has everything to offer the world. So Master Mastodon makes the ultimate sacrifice and kills himself, lets his soul get trapped in the Changsheng weapons for all eternity, under the promise that Po eventually destroys all of the Changsheng weapons, which Po agrees to. In the end, Po manages to obtain all of the Changsheng weapons from the Queen of Taikal, and thus ends the second season. Oh yeah, and then there's the holiday special where they celebrate the Lunar New Year with a story being told by Po and Mr. Ping. It's not really important. Let's move on. Season 3 begins with Po and the Dragon Knights being captured by the pirates, as apparently the Pirate Queen For Ruzon is searching after Mr. Ping, because apparently Mr. Ping used to be a pirate, and in fact at one point dated the Pirate Queen For Ruzon, and thus ended up breaking her heart when he decided to go back to his noodle restaurant and raise Po as his own son. Eventually, Mr. Ping manages to find forgiveness with the Pirate Queen, and thus everyone's an ally, except for one thing. Luthera and Colin decided to summon the Knights of England, which led to Pirate Island essentially being destroyed, and the Dragon Knights are captured when they decide not to hand over the world's most powerful weapons to the Knights of England, and thus, while they are taken to England, Mr. Ping and the Pirate Queen For Ruzon manage to take away the weapons and take them to a remote island of mages, the same one from season 2, and Mr. Ping promised that he would bring the weapons to England at some point in the future within a month. Unfortunately, this means during that time, Po and the Wandering Blade and the rest of the Dragon Knights are all captured by the Knights of England until they escape. And with that in mind, they have to find the last Changsheng weapons, Master Mastodon's Misting Storm Wheels, which was taken by Sir Alfred. After contacting the Queen of England and having a conversation with her, they discover that Sir Alfred was given a mission to help protect a village from a bog monster, and after that mission, which was unsuccessful, Alfred demanded a vacation where he went to South America, and he came back with one of the Storm Wheels, and now the Dragon Knights decide to go contact that same bog monster, who tells them that the weapons can only be destroyed in the forge they were made, the Forge of Changsheng. Unfortunately, thanks to Pangaea's divide, the Changsheng temple was hidden underneath London, and thus the Dragon Knights have to search London for a symbol, and when they eventually do find it, they find the Changsheng Forge and discover that Alfred didn't actually destroy the Storm Wheel. Instead, he turned it into the Luthera's shield, which is the sword that Luthera has been carrying around for the entire series.
Luthera's shield.
But it's a sword.
Yes, but its purpose is to protect you.
That is, until it was stolen by Sir Drake, who took it when they were attacking the pirates. And unfortunately, this means the Dragon Knights now have to divide and conquer. While Po and the other Dragon Knights end up going into the dock so they can reunite with Mr. Ping and For Ruzon, who have the rest of the Changsheng weapons, Luthera and her mother try to convince Sir Drake to give them the sword, but unfortunately they end up eventually taking away Luthera's shield from him, and thus they bring all the weapons to the Forge of Changsheng, where a final battle against Sir Drake happens. That is, until Veruca, who has been hunting them this entire time, ends up finding and claiming all of the Changsheng weapons for herself, including Luthera's shield, which means that she now has the power to summon all the army of the defeated ancient masters, including Master Mastodon, and use them to her own power. And this even includes Sir Alfred, who was apparently defeated by the Changsheng weapons when he was killed by his own sword. Po ends up revealing to Veruca that Klaus is still alive, which gives Veruca that emotional struggle that breaks the connection between her and the control of the other demons, which makes it so Sir Alfred can actually take the sword from Veruca and kill her with it. And thus, Alfred becomes the master of the Changsheng weapons, and while Po ends up giving the weapons to Alfred so that he can destroy them, Alfred ends up using them to make it so that Pangaea is reunited. The world is no longer broken. He's going to unite the world under one land once again, just as it once was. Unfortunately, this begins the end of season 3 and the start of season 4. Okay, actually, no. Let me explain. So, season 3 happens to have 19 episodes, but in my opinion, that's way too long. So, for my personal viewing experience, I decided to split it into 2 seasons, where I have the first 11 episodes be season 3 and the remaining 8 be season 4, as they're both kind of their own thing. Since Sir Drake and Veruca are the main villains of the first half, while Sir Alfred is the main villain of the second half. Because when season 4 happens, Alfred manages to bring the entire world together back into Pangaea, which causes problems across the entire country. And Po, feeling sorry for himself, has a bit of an emotional struggle, and yeah, there's that. Luthera tries to help make him feel better and succeeds, and thus the Dragon Knights, who have been struggling with problems all over the world, decide to band together again to take down Sir Alfred, and thus they have a bit of a problem, as in order to take down Sir Alfred, they need to find the Ancient Masters so they can destroy the Changsheng weapons and bring the world back to order. But unfortunately, there's just one problem. They don't know how to find the Ancient Masters without a connection. Thankfully, they do find a connection in Klaus, who is still alive and living on Mage Island, and he's actually the only living descendant of the ancient masters that they fought against. And with that connection, the Dragon Knights find him and rescue him from Sir Alfred, and then they have to find a way to get Klaus to connect with his magical powers, and when that happens, they manage to forge a connection with the Ancient Masters, who tell them that they need all 4 Ancient Masters to destroy the Changsheng weapons, and unfortunately, Master Mastodon is still under the control of Sir Alfred. So, the Dragon Knights and Sir Alfred, and pretty much everybody, have a final battle against Sir Alfred and his Changsheng weapons, and they manage to break Master Mastodon's connection, which ends up making it so that Master Mastodon can work with the Ancient Masters to destroy the Changsheng weapons. And with that happens, all of the Ancient Masters, including Sir Alfred, Master Mastodon, and Veruca, their souls are finally laid to rest, and the world is broken once again and balance is restored, which makes it so everyone is happy and the world is rejoicing in peace now that it's no longer at risk of being destroyed. So the series ends on a good note, and Po is ready for the next adventure in his journey. And we don't actually know what that is. It's probably going to be Kung Fu Panda 5, as Kung Fu Panda 4 is supposedly a prequel to this series. So there's that. Overall, I actually really enjoyed this TV show. It had a really nice story, if a bit dragged out and filled with mostly filler episodes. But overall, I really enjoyed this TV show, especially the voice acting, and I'm glad they got Jack Black back for this. But at the same time, I loved the animation, but I also wish it was a bit more nicer as it was back in The Paws of Destiny. Still, I really enjoyed this show, and I hope that you guys did too. More importantly, I hope you guys enjoyed this review, as it's probably time I wrap this up. So with that in mind, I hope that you guys enjoyed, and if you did, please like and subscribe so you can keep up to date on all things DreamWorks. Next week, I will actually be doing a review of the fourth Kung Fu Panda movie. Man, I cannot wait for that. But at the same time, I hope that you guys are staying safe out there, and I will see you all in my next video. Until then, bye-bye.
Faruka, cackle a bit less obviously, would you?
Right.